has brought us into his banqueting hall, and his banner over us is love.
Love is kind.
His banner over us is love.
It's not just a boastfulness.
His banner over us is
good day, dear viewers. Welcome to Bible Banquet. Here we are again, Samuel, Theodore, and Constance, gathered to study another aspect of our grand theme, the promise, God's everlasting covenant. One of the most breathtaking sights in nature is the rainbow. I remember growing up as a child, the appearance of the rainbow was always a moment of great excitement and awe. The rainbow symbolizes peace, faith, hope, change, reconciliation, and unity all through history. In some circles, in most recent times, the rainbow has even come to symbolize hope and deliverance from the COVID-19 pandemic. For the natural scientist, the rainbow is simply a phenomenon caused by the interaction between sunlight and water droplets. But for us, Bible-believing Christians, it is the symbol of God's promise, the symbol of that covenant which God established with Noah and every living creature for all future generations. Join us as we zoom in on God's covenant with Noah. We'd like to begin with a word of prayer, and we will invite Constance to pray for us.
Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for another opportunity to be in your presence. Thank you for the opportunity to study your word. We ask for your Holy Spirit's power upon us at this time, and upon our viewers and our listeners, upon our crew members. We ask, O God, that you will be in charge, Amen. That you will put your words in our mouth and help us to understand your written word so that we can share with our friends out there. At the end of this discussion, may all glory and honor be given to your holy name. We ask in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Dear viewers, we will not cease to thank you for your support and for your prayers towards the success of this program. We are pleased to allow God to use us to spread his word, and we continue to ask for grace and for strength so that together we will all grow in greater knowledge of him. We are talking about the covenant between God and Noah, and of course we will see that it extends to all generations. We did begin to talk about this on our last edition. It was just an overview, and today we want to specifically talk about that covenant between God and Noah. But before we get to Noah, let's begin from Genesis chapter 1. We'll be reading Genesis chapter 1, verse 31. We'll also read Genesis 3, verse 6, and verses 11 to 13. Then we will jump to Genesis chapter 4, verses 5, 8, 19, and 23. And then Genesis chapter 6, verses 2, 5, and 11. It's all in Genesis.
Mm-hmm.
Genesis chapter 1, verse 31. I'm reading from the New King James Version. Then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Amen.
Amen.
Genesis chapter 3, I'll be reading verses 6 and then 11 to 13. Verse 6. So when the woman saw that a tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Verses 11 to 13. And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat?" Then the man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I ate." And the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." Mm. It's hard to say amen.
It's very hard, very hard.
Genesis chapter 4, verses 5, 8, 19, and 23. Hmm. Reading from the New American Standard Bible. Genesis 4, 5, 8, 19, and 23. Verse 5. But for Cain and for his offering he had no regard. So Cain became very angry, and his countenance fell. Verse 8. And Cain told Abel his brother, and it came about when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel his brother and killed him. Hmm. Verse 19. And Lamech took to himself two wives. The name of the one was Ada, and the name of the other Zillah. And verse 23. And Lamech said to his wives, Ada and Zillah, "Listen to my voice, you wives of Lamech. Give heed to my speech, for I have killed a man for wounding me, and a boy for striking me."
Genesis chapter 6, verses 2, 5, and 11. I'm reading from the New King James Version. "That the Son of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose." Verse 5. "Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." Verse 11. "The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence."
From everything being so good in Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, God said everything was so good. All of a sudden, we move to Genesis chapter 3, verse 6, and there Eve is tempted. She falls, and things start getting bad, and they get worse as time moves on. How did sin affect humanity and creation at large?
If we read Genesis chapter 3, from verse Genesis chapter 3, verses 5 to 9, the Bible says, "Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked." Mm. You know, the effect of sin. Obviously, the Bible is saying their eyes were opened. You ask the question, were they blind before? So obviously it was not talking about physical, you know, openness. Mm-hmm. The glory of God left them. The consciousness of the reality of sin and its effects dawned on them. And so they saw nakedness. And you ask me, were they wearing dress before? And if they were wearing dress before, did God strip them of physical dress? And then they have to make figs to cover themselves. So it means that something beyond physical dress left them, and they realized they were naked. And that nakedness was not just physical nakedness. They covered themselves, but fear came, you know, anxiety, guilt. And so something happened to the image of God that we, God in which God created man. And beyond that, you could also see a distortion of their thoughts. Because in verse 9, God said, "Where are you?" And then verse 10 of Genesis chapter 3, Adam started babbling. I heard your voice. I am afraid. I was naked. I hid myself. That was not what was expected. Mm-hmm. So it just shows that there was immediate departure. And then when you look at it again, God went ahead to curse the ground. So thorns and thistles also grew, and that had its own ripple effect. So the land was affected. The topography of the earth was affected. Ellen White talks about leaves dropping, the colors of the effect of sin was not just on human beings, it was in nature also, and much more.
So what observations do we then make about the progression of sin? Because we have seen that sin affected all that God created. What about the progression, looking at the Bible passages that we read?
Well, when one sin is like a seed you plant on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
You plant one grain of corn and it produces a cob and much more than one cob. Mm-hmm. If sin is not checked, it can go to any limit. And if you, even with what we have read, Adam and Eve sin, their children have also learned. Cain had his own way of thinking, not what God told him to do. He chose to go his own way. Decided what sacrifice he will offer to God. And then he did the same thing that I would say his parents did. When God asked Adam what he did, he said, "The woman you gave me." Blame Cain came in. Cain also blamed Abel for God not receiving his offering. And he tricked him into the field and killed him. Very quickly, you say, how did he get to that point?
That's it.
What got into his mind? And when God asked him, "Where is your brother?" he lied. "I don't know.
Am I responsibility?"
And then he told God, "I'm not responsible for my brother." He got angry for that. If we read beyond that, he was even the one that more angry.
Angry. And then God asked him, why would you be angry?
And we are quickly going. We get to Lamech. I'm just jumping. Mm-hmm. And I believe that these are only examples.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. They are not what's happening in the 7-8 generations we are talking about. I think what God reveals for us are just things that will give us examples and make sure that we know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So you think about all that, and Lamech, where did he get the concept of marrying more than one wife?
You just keep asking how did it
happen? And then he got two wives, and somebody offended him. Well, his great grandfather Cain killed.
He killed his
wives. I've killed, out of anger.
Vengeance.
Oh.
And he was not even remorseful.
He wasn't remorseful. If you notice, from the beginning, they were not remorseful. They kept throwing the thing back to God.
As God, yes.
Back to God, or for choosing not to obey him. Why should God even complain? So we can go down, even in our world today, one sin leads to the other. Somebody tells a lie, and he wants to quickly find ways to cover that lie.
Yeah.
And that could result to murder, could result to stealing, it could result to any kind of thing, faking, false certificates, whatever it takes.
Yeah.
Sin is very progressive, and that text in, I think, James, that says that when you lust, it results to sin.
James chapter 1, verses 13 and 14.
Yes, sin cannot even, temptations comes to all of us. Mm-hmm. Temptations come to all of us. But it's only as your heart yields to it, and you fall, that becomes sin. But once that sin comes,
once it's planted,
it will get to everything and will end in death.
So I can say that when we read Genesis chapter 6, verse 5, and verse 11.
I was going to ask her that question.
Okay, you're gonna ask. Okay.
No, but maybe since you've started,
now,
you could help us.
When we read Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 and 11, we can now understand that God was actually right.
Yeah.
A lot had happened from the time of Adam and Eve until that time. So when he said every imaginations of their heart was evil continually. It means that there has been a progression. And like Constance has said, a progression of irresponsibility. You know, I have killed a man, Lamech said, because of self-defense. He could rationalize the death of a fellow human being because he wanted to defend him, to defend himself. So that sin, that thing that happened in the garden, took a toll on humanity. And to the point that God had no other choice than to judge the first world, you know, by way of destruction.
And God had to destroy the first world, but in the midst of all of this corruption, in the midst of this degradation, there was something positive. There was someone positive that God found. We will talk about this person right after the break. Don't go away. Welcome back, dear viewers. Our lesson today is titled All Future Generations. Up to this point, we have discovered that God created everything very good. And from that moment, sometime later, we don't know how long later, sin came into the world. And that began a progression that led humanity in a downward trend to the point where the Bible says God regretted making man. But in the midst of all of this destruction, in the midst of this corruption, in the midst of this evil, God found someone who appeared to be different. We want to talk about that person now. Let's read what the Bible has to say about him. We'll be reading from Genesis chapter 6, verses 8 and 9, and 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. Theodore, you read that for us. And Constance will read Genesis 6, verse 18, and Genesis 7, verse 23.
Genesis 6, verses 8 and 9. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God. Amen.
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 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. And did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Genesis chapter 6, verse 18. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall enter the ark, you and your sons and your wife, and your sons' wives with you. 7:23. Thus he blotted out every living thing that was upon the face of the land, from men to animals, to creeping things, and to birds of the sky, and they were blotted out from the earth, and only Noah was left, together with those that were with him in the ark.
Amen.
Amen. This one we can say amen.
We can say amen here. We have discovered, dear viewers, that this person God called was none other than Noah. What led to the call of Noah? What made him different from his generation? We have described how terrible the world was at this point, but the Bible says he was just, perfect, he walked with God. Was Noah a superhuman?
Noah wasn't superhuman, but Noah loved the Lord.
Mm.
Jesus said, blessed is the man who hungers and thirsts after righteousness,
mm-hmm.
for he shall be filled. I think Noah was hungry for righteousness.
Mm.
And
midst of a perversity
What, what made his lifestyle unique were the circumstances he found himself.
Mm-hmm.
Noah lived in a world, you know, that was terrible. Jesus in Matthew 24, reading from verse 39 down, described it again as it was in the days of Noah, which means the days of Noah was a terrible time,
mm-hmm.
you know. Mm-hmm. But in the midst of that, of incest, of homosexuality, of lesbianism, of all kinds of things that happened, we see a man who stood up. And the Bible described him using some unique words.
Mm-hmm.
He was righteous. He was blameless. He walked with God.
Mm-hmm.
And I could see a man who did not take pleasure in his shortcomings.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I see a man who was willing to come back to God after a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
And God was watching.
Mm-hmm.
And he found him, not because he never sinned.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
God's grace located Noah,
mm-hmm.
because Noah's heart was connected with God's heart.
That's right.
Constance, you're talking about God's grace. God's grace, exactly. The text says that Noah found grace,
mm-hmm.
in the eyes of the Lord. How are we to understand that statement? Usually when we talk about grace, we wait, or many people tend to look at the New Testament. But here we are in the Old Testament and Noah found grace. What does that mean?
Maybe Theodor will answer that question, but let me say my little bit because he will tell us he's an Old Testament scholar. But my Bible
mm-hmm.
makes it very easy.
Okay.
My Bible says Noah found favor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And when I think about the word favor,
yeah,
I think about, and when I was a student
mm-hmm.
on my undergraduate study, when I finished, they will say, well, you are very busy with all the church work and this. How do you pass and pass very well? I will say, haven't you heard that the definition of grace is an unmerited favor?
Mm-hmm.
So when my Bible calls, this New American Standard Bible calls it favor, it's grace is something you don't deserve.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about God and from Him. God loves us so much. He wants us to enjoy life. That's what He did for Adam and Eve. Put them in a garden with everything full. That's grace.
Mm.
God has located Noah because of his relationship with him. In fact, Ellen White says that Noah was an unbending witness for God.
Mm-hmm.
In another place, I read that even if he didn't preach, his life alone
was enough sermon.
And that every stroke of the hammer was a witness.
Mm-hmm.
He was not someone who spoke something else and lived differently.
Yeah.
God says in 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 30 that He will honor those
who honor Him.
Who honor him.
That's right. You know, talking about grace, you're not done, Constance.
Go ahead.
You know, talking about grace in the Old Testament, I want to say that, like Constance has said, the outlay of the garden, the creation process itself, is full of grace.
Mm-hmm.
But grace manifested after the fall, in the sense that when we read the story of the fall in Genesis chapter 3, you will notice that God first of all punished the serpent,
mm-hmm.
and after punishing the serpent in Genesis 3:14. He made the plan of salvation. He pronounced the plan of salvation.
Yeah, I like the fact you said he pronounced.
Yeah, he pronounced. I caught myself before you catch me. You know. He pronounced the plan of salvation in verse 15
mm-hmm.
before he punished Adam and Eve.
But even before then, he sewed, he made skin. You know, when he saw that Adam
clothes
and Eve.
Clothes of skin.
Yes, he made clothes of skin from
No, no,
them
the cloth of skin was made after, in verse 21, if we take it chronologically. In verse 15, in verse 14, the serpent was punished. In verse 15, the plan of salvation was made.
The seed.
You know, that plan, which means grace. So God's grace went ahead before he judged, he punished them. Mm-hmm. Now, verse 16, he faced Adam and then Eve.
So, and in fact, when I was thinking about this grace thing, I said, you know, it's even right there in the garden, when he knew they sinned, he came.
He came, That's came grace
then.
Already.
That's you know,
grace.
We're already in that. He came. He called.
He called,
And he asked them,
where are you?
Even
where
though he knew what they had
he
done.
He knew. Because see, when if the two of us have issues, if I'm guilty, it is difficult for me to approach you.
That's right.
And it is said that you, who are stronger than me at that particular
should be
the one to come. You know, because I'm probably guilt may, and shame may never allow me to come and own up to what I've done. God knowing what they had done and how they were feeling at that particular
came
time,
to him,
came
to them.
To them.
And
that's grace.
That's grace.
So grace started right there.
That is it.
You know.
So by Genesis chapter, you know, after he had punished them, God still went ahead to institute the substitutionary sacrifice by slaying an innocent animal to make atonement for them and then to cover their nakedness. Theologically, we'll say that when you juxtapose chapter 3, verse 7 with chapter 3 verse 21. You see, in 3 verse 7, they made dress for themselves, righteousness by works. But now, an animal was killed to cover them, righteousness, you know, by
faith.
By faith. And then Hebrews 9:12 tells 22. Hebrews 9:22 tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So that act of killing that animal was grace. Their lives that was supposed to have been taken away was redeemed somehow, pointing ultimately to the to the sacrifice
redemption
of Jesus Christ. So the Old Testament is full of grace. It's full of grace for Adam and Eve to even have the privilege of still producing the next succeeding generations after they have sinned is grace.
I would say even the fact that God did not let them have access to the tree of life and live eternally in sin
is also
still
grace.
An aspect
So when the word is used in Hebrews and in Genesis chapter 6 verse 8, we don't need to be surprised because grace
has permeated.
Has been there all the time.
All the time. Now let's go to the responsibilities that God placed on Noah. Maybe we have evoked it somehow, but let's talk about that a little more. What were these responsibilities? So we're talking about the covenant, and the covenant comes with responsibilities, as we saw in our last edition.
Build an ark. Gather everybody. Bring the animals.
Preach.
Preach the word.
Preach
the gospel. You know, if you go to Genesis chapter 7 verse 12, it said, of the clean animals, seven. Of the unclean, two. Instructions. So he had a job to do. His job was to bring in the word at his time. And you know, there were no barriers. Everybody that is willing should come. Which means the ark must have been very big, massive. So let them come. He built it, finished the building, and then let them enter.
I would also say that part of that responsibility was for Noah to continue to live a blameless life. Because it's as people saw
his life.
Even when he was not preaching to them, they saw this man who consistently preached. And then even when people mocked him and thought he was crazy and something was wrong with him,
he continued to be faithful.
That was the responsibility that God has given to
him.
That's why God chose him, because God knew he would not disappoint
him.
God bless you. You know. And then God said in verse 18, I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall come into the ark. You, your sons, your wives, and your sons' wives, and with you.
That leads me to my next question.
Okay. But that's a huge responsibility.
My next question, exactly, on that Bible passage, you know. You said initially that as Noah was preaching, everybody was expected to come.
Yes,
I mean, it was an open invitation.
Of course, of course.
But this text is saying, I'm making a covenant with you, Noah, with your wife, and with your sons, and your sons' wives. What about the others? Did that mean that they were excluded? From the time of this pronouncement, maybe I should push this question a little further. Did they still have that free will, the free will to choose whether to enter into the ark or not? Or was entering into the ark simply in honor of this covenant that God made?
You know, I like the way Constance said it. God saw that Noah will not fail.
Mm-hmm.
Before God sets us up, because God does set us up, okay? Before he sets you up, he is sure that you will not fail. Of course, Job
set
didn't
us up.
Know.
Set us up in the sense of...
Oh, no, God sets us up for good.
Okay.
Because he needs to clarify that. When God was entering a bet with Satan concerning Job, he was confident Job will not fail, even though Job didn't know what was going on.
Okay,
and I think it's a privilege for you and I to live our lives in a way that
God
can be sure
count
that
and depend on us.
Go and try. If you
Daniel,
like.
Yeah.
No,
Hananiah,
like
Mishael, Azariah.
Azariah. Mm-hmm.
So when you look at this situation, you see that God has seen Noah, that he is a faithful man. God has watched him and his family. Not because the children, because I was wondering, what about maybe one of the daughters-in-laws would have said, I'm not, this thing you people are doing is trash. I'm not going to be part of it. But you see, there was something about the patriarchs that is lacking in contemporary family systems. And that's the fact that the relationship between God and some of the patriarchs was so high, towered so high, that their children, their wives, believed in the God they believed in. We talk about Abraham. Some time ago, we discussed about how a grown-up, you know, Isaac, we bring out his two hands for the father to tie, and then
lay him on the
wood, and then they want to kill him. Contemporary young people, will they do that? So for a young person today to do that, it means that there is something about dad or mom and God that I can believe in.
So
I think that God has seen that kind of relationship between Noah and his family before he could entrust that responsibility on him. Not that they were predestined to be saved. In fact, it was a high obligation for him and his family to continue to live a life of example to others.
And I think that if it was only for them, God wouldn't have asked him to preach.
That's right.
He preached for 120 years.
Yeah.
And he wouldn't have even allowed other people to build the ark. Those other people that built the ark, they were witnesses to what was going on. You know.
Noah had to preach, like you said, and he preached for 120 years. People definitely helped him build the ark, but only these 8 people we're talking about were saved. Why do we think people rejected Noah's message? We'll come back to that question. It's time for a break. We'll be right back.
Son of my soul, O Savior dear, it is not night if thou be near. O may no earth-born cloud arise to hide thee from thy servant's eyes.
When the soft dews of kindly sleep, my wearied eyelids gently steep, be my last thought, how sweet forever on my Savior.
Welcome back, dear viewers. We have been talking about Noah today, and our lesson is captioned, All Future Generations. Imagine a man preaching for 120 years, building this massive boat called an ark, and yet only 8 people were saved. In fact, just his family members. What do we think hindered people in Noah's time from accepting this message of salvation which he preached? And what are those things that hinder us today from being open, receptive to spiritual truths?
Unbelief.
Oh. Very serious.
Unbelief. It had never rained before that time.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, there is this philosophy about seeing is believing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it had never rained. So for them, they didn't think that was true. They thought Noah was the dead. And if you don't have a relationship with God, you cannot hear him. They didn't have relationship with God. Even though Noah was preaching and calling them, they didn't even have the time to consider what he was saying.
So
again, when we don't have open minds, it affects us. Because if you, I have a friend that I'm talking to. I said, just open your mind and allow the Holy Spirit to work with you. He's a student, but he's closed. Nothing can move him beyond where he is.
Mm.
And so if you don't have relationship with God, I'm not judging him.
Mm-hmm.
It's difficult for you to understand who is talking to you. In John chapter 10, verse 27, Jesus says, my sheep
knows my voice.
Hear my voice. Mm. They know me and they follow me.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't have that, it's difficult. If you don't have faith in God, I'm always talking about Hebrews 11, verse 6. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. If you don't have faith in God, when you hear things about God, it does not move you. Today, and I believe even in those days, there are too many distractions. See, Genesis chapter 6, verse, chapter 6, verse 2 says that the sons of God started to marry the daughters of men. Why? Because they were beautiful. Attraction, physical attraction.
That's right.
The Bible says that God looks in the heart, but man's look in the outward appearance. So we like glittering things. We like things that move us, things that are fast for us to do. Evil is very attractive. People don't want to be called names. You know, Noah was a righteous person. Righteous. I don't want to get there.
Holy.
They don't want to be different. They don't want to be unique. They don't want to feel uncomfortable when they're in the midst of family or friends. They want to join them. So many of those things distract us. But you see, lack of spending time with God affects us most. Because if you don't spend time with him in his word, on your knees, listening to him, noise, too much noise can distract us all the time. If we don't spend time with God, it is difficult for us to know when he's talking to us.
And to
hear his voice. And there's so many, many voices around us. So with what is happening in our today's world, I could reflect on what was happening then. Because Noah had chosen to walk with God, he could hear God speaking to him. But the others,
could not
hear him.
Yeah, I think I don't need to go back to that. But Paul says something concerning our generation today, because the same trouble. You know, like I mentioned earlier, Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, they were eating and drinking. It's not because there was anything wrong with marrying and giving to marriage, but
that was the focus.
Their marriage was the basis, the value system has been eroded. It
collapsed.
Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 17 and to 19, Paul said, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Now, why is it that people watch today the salvation booth? Jesus said, come, enter. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe, why is it difficult? Why is it that people choose otherwise Noah's time has come and gone. What is the problem today? Where is there so much immorality? Why is it that people feel more comfortable to stay around where, you know, they can have their way, do whatever they want to do, than go to church? Why is it that young people have left the church in the Western world? Why is it that there is so
in Africa?
Why is it that, you know, there is kidnapping? Little young people are the ones who are championing, you know, robbery and all kinds of things. It's because, like she has said, the heart is not with God.
Mm.
And then in Romans chapter 1, verses 27 to 29, you know, Paul also talked about, even as they did not retain God in their knowledge, he had given them a reprobate mind. So Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 talks about, my people perish because of lack of knowledge of God. So when we reject the word of God, when we reject biblical principles, what follows is crisis.
Mm-hmm.
And that is where the word has got to. Many, even who claim to believe in the word of God, do it at their convenience. That need to transform, to surrender the heart completely to God
daily
is still far away.
And sometimes it is when they want to use the word of God to their benefit.
That's why I use convenience. People worship conveniently. And we spend time sometimes here talking about empty rituals.
Mm.
People also go to church, even among Christians, you know, just for going sake. I'm a Christian.
To mark the calendar.
So we need to deal with all of that if we must escape from the final destruction that is coming.
And we know that Satan is the chief champion of all this. And so he keeps bringing things that distract us.
Of course.
We are so busy. And every good thing that God has given to us, he would have a counterfeit of us, of it, in order to distract us further and further. And it's not going to get better.
Mm. We need to watch out.
Yes.
In all of this story, the Bible comes to the conclusion that Noah alone was left. Well, not alone as a single human being, alone with his family around him. And that sounds more like he and his family made up a sort of remnant.
Yes.
They were the remnant of that era.
Mm-hmm.
How does Noah's story illustrate the concept of the remnant? Because it's a concept we keep on finding all through the Bible.
Remnant ecclesiology is a very big field, you know, in theology, and especially in Christian church. And it started out from the Garden of Eden. From the time Adam and Eve sinned, God decided to preserve a lineage for himself.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the promise was that there's going to be a seed.
Mm-hmm.
I'll put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. So that seed of the woman becomes God's remnant.
Mm.
And in every generation. Don't forget, you know, I like what Constance said before your question. Satan is working to destroy God's plan.
Yes.
You know, when you read Genesis chapter 3 verse 15 very well, you see that it is couched in the context of the great controversy.
Mm.
So that controversy continues. Why do you think people at the time of Noah became so evil continually? Satan doesn't want the plan of God to be fulfilled, but God will always have a people.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fortunate that it was Noah's family.
It is God's covenant.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So, his covenant.
Yes, God's covenant can never be broken.
Mm-hmm.
So when you move beyond that, as we saw, you know, in the last discussion, God has always had a remnant, and it continues until it became Israel, and even to the end of time. Revelation chapter, you know, chapter 12 verse 17, Revelation chapter 14 verse 12 also talks about remnant.
Mm-hmm.
So even at the end of time, God will have
the patience
of
the saints,
remnant.
Those who keep his
commandments. When you look at the characteristics of that remnant, you know, one can say that the Seventh Adventist Church fits into that remnant. Those who have the faith of Jesus, keep the commandments of God, and have the faith of Jesus. It's not enough to say, I have accepted Jesus as my Lord and personal Savior. We must endeavor to keep all of his commandments as a response to his love for us.
Mm-hmm. Let's take another passage, and think with that passage we will end where we began. We're talking about the rainbow, Genesis chapter 9, verses 12 to 17. Constance, will you please help us read?
Genesis chapter 9, verses 12 to 17. And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant which I am making between me and you, and every living creature that is with you, for all successive generations. I set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a sign of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come about, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And never again shall the water become a flood to destroy all flesh."
Amen.
16. "When the bow is in the cloud, then I will look upon it to remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. And God said to Noah, 'This is the sign of the covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth.'"
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thinking about how many times he kept saying, "For the people that are living and all creatures of the earth," in my Bible, and you know, about at least three times.
Establishing its universal nature.
Exactly. So what's unique about the covenant symbol? You seem to have started to answer that.
It's
so evident.
You know, listening to your introduction is amazing. The science, philosophy, psychology have given different shades of their interpretation of the rainbow.
Mm-hmm.
But look at the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Many years back, God said, "It's a sign
between me
and you,
covenant."
And anytime you see it, remember, I said, this whole earth will not be destroyed with water anymore. So anybody can think of it from any perspective. But what I know is that anytime I see the rainbow, I remember the God of the universe who, in his benevolence, decided not to destroy the earth with water again. You know, and then, I don't know, God is just loving. It was in the midst of the destruction of the wicked that God was making a covenant, an everlasting covenant for all generations.
Yes.
In the midst of annoyance.
For all future generations.
You know, for all future generations. In the midst of that. So we see that God is different from us.
Mm.
God is loving. Nothing can change his loving kindness, even with our disappointments, our misbehaviors, our not recognizing his power and grace in our lives. God is still focused on his covenant of producing that seed that will save humanity.
He also knows that even though he's given us the freedom of choice, he knows that there are people that will choose right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, he knows.
So this covenant with Noah affects every one of us.
Yeah.
Because there are people, Theodore mentions Revelation 14, 12, here are the patience of the saints, that regardless of what happens, they have made their choice and they will remain in the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Where humans, they sin, they get up, they ask for forgiveness, they continue moving because they know that God is faithful and will not deny himself.
So the rainbow tells us a lot about God and his love for humans.
Everlasting.
It's
love.
Not just for colors.
But what about all of nature? You know, because in that text you read, God does not just say it's for human beings.
Mm.
He says every living creature.
Well, because when the flood came, it wiped off everything.
Mm-hmm.
Humans, beasts, trees,
everything.
And God said it will not happen again. He will not use the flood to do that anymore. So nature will be restored as humans will be restored. And last time we talked about the new earth.
The new earth.
Yeah, we're talking about the new earth. I have quickly gone to Revelation chapter 22, you know, to say that, look, the Revelation chapter 22, verses 1 to 5, describe the condition of the new earth.
Mm-hmm.
There will be trees.
Yeah.
There will be restoration.
There will
be
animals.
God loves nature.
We spent time talking about this in the book of Isaiah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And God will restore the
all
earth.
Things, yes.
Mm-hmm. He will. Even right now, he's not happy because he says that
he will destroy those who destroy the earth. So he's not even happy with the way we are messing up the world. He will bring everything to normalcy. He will restore everything.
So before the final restoration that we look for, God also puts a responsibility on us to care for the nature. Because we right from the beginning, before sin entered, man had the responsibility of tending the garden, protecting it. So we need to protect our environment, knowing fully well that Psalm 19 verses 1 lines 1 and 2 talk about they declare the glory,
of God.
And just as the rainbow declares the glory of God, everything around us, nature declares the glory of God, we too are created to declare the glory of God.
A few days ago I was talking with some of my children, some students. And I was telling them that if you must have a pet, then be ready to take care of your pet. I said, the way we take care of pets in this part of the world, I don't like it. So I'd rather not have
one
than to have and, you know, treat them as nothing. If you have lived overseas or have friends overseas and know how they treat their pets, you know, you wouldn't be happy with the way some pets are treated here. So even God cares for pets. God sees the little sparrows fall, you know. And everything that God created, he takes care of. And he has given us that responsibility. That's what he placed in the hands of Adam and Eve to dress.
And keep.
I love
and
that.
Keep. But people have changed it to
trample
upon.
And to exploit.
And God requires, as long as we remain in him, it is our responsibility to keep doing that and also remind people around us that human beings, beasts, creatures, trees, everything that God has created for a purpose and will restore, and we don't have to trash them.
It's on this note that we end this lesson. It's been an interesting one for us. I believe it's also been for you. We thank God that this covenant did not just end with Noah, but this covenant extends to all of us. And by extension, we can be part. And just like Noah had obligations, we also are expected to respect our obligations. And we know that by depending on Jesus, we can live just as Noah lived. We'd like to leave you with a word of prayer. We look forward to meeting you on our next edition, where we'll be talking about another aspect of the covenant. We'll ask Theodore to pray for us.
Let us pray. Dear Father, thank you for the opportunity to study your word. We asked for wisdom and grace in the beginning, and you have granted. Glory be to your name.
Amen.
Thank you for your grace and loving kindness that has unfolded in this study in spite of human sinfulness and degradation. Thank you for being loving and caring. Thank you for the consistency of your undying love. Father, we pray that just as you blessed the whole world through Noah's family, help that each of us in our lives and our family will remain blessings to our generation.
Amen.
Help us to live to glorify you, so that when the end comes, we will have the opportunity to see you face to face. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.